I was shocked and appealed to Mr. Heath's honor. He said that he had signed no writing with me, was in no way legally bound, and that it was his duty to do the best he could for the heirs. Mr. Olmsted was sorry, but could not help me. The new tenants would not require him to incur any risk, and my matter was at an end. Of course, I immediately informed myself as to the character of Peel's Museum Company. It proved to be a band of speculators who had bought Peel's collection for a few thousand dollars, expecting to unite the American Museum with it, issue and sell stock to the amount of $50,000, pocket $30,000 profit, and permit the stockholders to look out for themselves. I went immediately to several of the editors, including Major M.M. Noah, M.Y. Beach, my good friends West, Herrick and Ropes of the Atlantis, and others, and stated my grievances. "Now," said I, "if you will grant me the use of your columns, I'll blow that speculation sky high." They all consented, and I wrote a large number of squibs cautioning the public against buying the museum stock, ridiculing the idea of a board of broken-down bank directors engaging in the exhibition of stuffed monkeys and gander skins, appealing to the case of the Zoological Institute, which had failed by adopting such a plan as the one now proposed. And finally, I told the public that such speculation would be infinitely more ridiculous than Dickens' Grand United Metropolitan Hot Muffin and Crumpet Baking and Punctual Delivery Company. The stock was as dead as a herring. I then went to Mr. Heath and asked him when the directors were to pay the other $14,000. On the 26th day of December, or forfeit the $1,000 already paid, was the reply. I assured him that they would never pay it, that they could not raise it, and that he would ultimately find himself with the museum collection on his hands. And if once I started off with an exhibition for the self, I could not touch the museum at any price.